Because for the Jewish people, the Lord said that the eyes of the Jewish people will be closed until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And we understand that's very close. That's very close indeed. I was saved in 1980. In 1980, we had an idea that the Lord's return was very close. It's even closer now. We're given a number of signs to look for. And Jesus tells his disciples that these are the signs that will accompany the end of time, when I'm about to return. We do not know exactly when the time is, but we can say that we're living in the times of the signs today. There are more earthquakes taking place than ever before. It's not global warming that's causing it. The Lord told us that these things will take place. If you have a Bible, please turn to Isaiah 55, verse 7. Isaiah 55 and verse 7. We normally read round. In other words, each person reads a scripture. That way I can be certain that everyone's paying attention. They're not allowed to go to sleep. But I'll read the scriptures today. But I shall know if you've gone to sleep, because I shall see you snoring. Isaiah 55 verse 7. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. When I came to the Lord, as I said, it was in 1980. We understand that the Jews are moving back to their land. Israel is again a nation formed in 1948 in one day. Unheard of that any nation which was scattered so thoroughly amongst the world would still have their language, their governance, and their money. And they have come back together to Israel. And I understand from Jewish people that they can read the scriptures in the original language. It's still going on. And they read the scriptures and they understand exactly what the scriptures say. In other words, Hebrew hasn't changed. Understand also that more Jews have believed in Jesus in the last 18 months than believed in him for the last 1800 years. That's a sign of the end time. So, 37 years ago, is when I sort of thought about it. you like the foolish and the wise virgins? There's so many who consider they are ready for the Lord, but we need to take note that the foolish virgins were not ready. Matthew 25:10, it says, "And while they went out to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut." One of the most phenomenal things about a Jewish wedding is they have the virgins who line the route for the bridegroom. In this case, Jesus tells us about 10. 5 were ready and 5 were not ready. 5 didn't have oil in the lamps and they needed to go and buy some oil. But while they were buying oil, while they were getting ready for the bridegroom to arrive, he came, went into the marriage, closed the door, and they were outside. What a terrible thing to do, to be knocking on the door and to hear, "Get you away from me, I never knew you." I want to ask each one of you, if you died right now, are you certain that you would go to heaven? And if you say yes, I would ask you, if you did meet God and he asked you, "Why should I let you in?" what would you say? In 1979, I was, by the standard of the local people, a very successful man. I was president of the Lions Club of Kariba. And we were trying to fulfill a number of good causes. I was an inspector in the Rhodesian Police Force. Had my own company and I ran 2 businesses. I was a renowned DJ, believe it or not. And I played at one of the top hotels in the holiday center of Kariba. And I featured on TV and radio in various adverts and with the silhouettes. What a fulfilled life. Why then did I feel empty inside? As the war in Rhodesia progressed, I came to the realization there are very few of the 10 commandments that I had not broken. There came a time I was sitting in my lounge in Kariba, those houses that took one day to build. They completed one per day, 884 square feet, including the veranda, 3-bedroom house. And I was sitting in the lounge. It was late at night, and I got mad with God. Because I suddenly realized I had nothing. I could die tomorrow, and this whole lot that I had that people considered, wow, look at that man, would be God. I prayed to God. I say I prayed to God. I actually screamed at God. In the top of my voice, I said, Jesus Christ, if you're there, do something about this. It's the most honest prayer I've ever prayed. A little while later, a pastor bought the house. He actually came up to the shop on a Saturday and knocked at the door with his two little children. And I said to him, hi, who are you? He said, I've just moved in here. And I thought, an American. That's love. Remember, I was Royal Navy. And he said, I'm the new pastor in town. I said, how low can you go? So I gave his kids a penny whistle each and said, go and irritate your mum and dad. He said, I'm moving into the manse. I said, oh yeah, where's that? He said, I bought the house next to some police inspector on Boulder Ridge. I said, what number? He said, number 14. I said, I'm the police inspector. He bought the house next door to me. How dare he? He was there the following Tuesday. Looking over the house as he was doing work on it. And he saw me and he said, John, why don't you come up and we'll have dinner tonight. So when you're single, dinner's good in anything. Even Americans do. So I said, yeah, sure. In some ways, I was rather like Cornelius. Cornelius is a character in the Bible. In Acts chapter 10. In Acts chapter 10 it says, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band. A devout man, one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming into him and saying unto him, Cornelius. I want to finish there for a second. We have a devout man, a Roman soldier, who's heard of this God of the Jews and decided to pray to him. By modern standards, he was very religious. We are told that he was devout, he feared God, he gave alms to the people and prayed always. But as the story develops over the next two chapters, we realize one thing. Cornelius was not saved. Yeah, he was devout. He prayed to God, he feared God, he gave alms, but he wasn't saved. And he needed Peter to come and give him and tell him the words of life. I certainly wasn't devout, but I feared God, and I knew that one day he would judge me. I was working in the Lions Club to give alms to the people, to various good causes. And as I said, I prayed Rather, I screamed at God. Cornelius was still lost in his sin. Rather the same as me. For truly, I was still lost in sin. Let me ask, I don't want to see a show of hands, I really don't. Is there anyone here who would consider themselves devout, fearing God, giving to the poor, and constantly praying? And yet, like Cornelius and myself, you're still in your sin. In the Cornelius story, God sent Peter to speak to him the words of life, that he might be saved. In my story, God sent a pastor who bought the house next door to me, that I might hear the words of life. And in your story, you have come here this afternoon because God has brought you to hear the words of life. And I'm really scared of him in case I do not give it. There's nothing any of us can do without God. In John 3:16 it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but through the world, but through him the world might be saved. He that believeth on him, he that believeth on him, he that believeth on him is not condemned. But he that believeth not is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Did you know that God loves you so much that he gave his only begotten Son to die in your place, and all he asks us to do is believe? Do you believe in Jesus? There are many who believe, but it doesn't change their life. I was asked, "Do you know Jesus?" I sat in the little lounge in my pastor's place, and he said to me, "Do you know Jesus?" And I said, "Well, that's a bit difficult, because he died 2,000 years ago." He said, "I've got news for you. He raised from the dead 2,000 years ago. He's still alive today, and you can know him." And that really got me. In the scripture we just read, it said, "Whosoever believeth in him." In the Greek language, that word "believe" is a little bit different to what it is in English. We say, "I believe it's going to be a good day tomorrow." What we're saying really is, "I hope it'll be a good day tomorrow." In the Greek, to say "I believe" means I believe so much that it causes a change in my life. The fact is, when we say believe in the Lord Jesus, we mean commit your heart to Him and let Him change your life. So much so. In other words, if we have faith in something, it must cause us to change our lives, whatever we have faith in. Turning to the scripture we started with, Isaiah 55:7, let the wicked forsake his way and the righteous man his thoughts. Let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. That scripture is for the wicked and unrighteous. In that case, it must mean for everyone, because all of us are wicked and unrighteous. How do I know? If I ask you, do you tell a lie? If you're honest, you'll say yes. Therefore, God calls you a liar. If I ask you, do you steal? Oh no, I don't steal. A little bit of time off work. Tell a story to get time off. You steal from your boss. Fiddle your taxes. That's stealing. God calls you a thief. Do you use the name of the Lord in vain? Every single person I've met, and on television, time and time again, they use Jesus Christ as a swear word. They never say Muhammad, they never say Buddha. Why? Because Jesus is the only name under heaven whereby you might be saved. And so, I understand, if I said to the men, have you ever looked at a woman to lust after her? 99% would be honest and say, yes. If I say to the ladies, have you ever looked at a man to lust after him? God calls you a fornicator. So therefore, I understand by my own admission, I am a lying, thieving, blaspheming fornicator. How come God is going to forgive me when I stand in front of him? You see, the scripture tells me, Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Every one of us is a sinner. That's not being nice. I'm being honest. Don't think I'm lifting myself up. I'm not. That applies to me just as much as to anybody else. The scripture that follows it, Romans 3:24, says, being justified freely by his grace through through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. The redemption is in Christ Jesus. To rely on Him, what He has done 2,000 years ago cannot be undone. He died on a cross for you and for me. He died and gave His life that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. There's nothing we can do to add to that. It's not faith and this. It's just faith. Romans 4:5, it says, God, or Jesus, died for the ungodly. We have to admit that we're ungodly. Then Jesus died for us. God is waiting for you to bow before Him and to ask Him to save you. That's all it is. To bow before Him and ask Him to save you. Missing out an awful lot of my testimony, I remember going to church one particular day. Lester had got me going to church, and by then I had the special fruit pew, and don't let anybody sit in that pew because it was mine. You know what I mean? And he said, we're going to have an evangelist, and he's going to come and speak. So, John, I'd really like you to be there. And I went, and we sang some simple choruses, and I just started to cry. To this day, I can't tell you why I cried. I just cried. For 2 hours, that service went on, and for 2 hours, I cried. Donny Bosman, the evangelist, started to go around and say to people, stand up. Stand up, you. What have you got wrong? And the one woman said, I've hurt my back. I can't bend down. And he said, be here. And she burped, double, and straightened up. And I went, and cried again. At the end of the service, I thought, well, let everybody go. And I'll just sit here and wait till everybody's gone. Donny Bosman came over to me. And he said, I sense there's something wrong. If you've been crying for 2 hours, what is your face like? I sense there's something wrong. You clever idiot. And I said to him, yes. He didn't waste time on anything else. He said, do you know Jesus? I said, no. He said, do you want to know Him? I said, yes. And at 12:15, on the front left-hand pew of that church in Korea, I dedicated my life to Jesus Christ. 2nd of March, 1980. And I said, be my servant. Will you do the same this afternoon? Will you bow your head and say, I want Jesus as my Savior? God is waiting for you to ask. Because He will not save you unless you ask. That's the only thing you've got to do. Romans 10:9-10 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For the heart, with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. I want to ask you to quietly ask yourself, are you prepared to allow Jesus to change your life? I'm not going to give an altar call. I'm not going to ask or show anyone up by asking you to dedicate your life here. You will know what you feel. If you need any further encouragement, speak to me after, or speak to your host after, because they should be able to explain it to you. Does anyone have any questions? Trust I've given it correctly. Move by your Spirit on the hearts of people here, that they may know you, who to know is to have everlasting life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Just